Cryoglobulinemia is simply the presence of cryoglobulins in the serum. Cryoglobulins are immunoglobulins that reversibly precipitate and form a gel when the temperature is less than 37. The presence of cryoglobulins we determine by precipitation. Under the temperature under 37, cryoglobulins precipitate and form gel. And cryoprecipitate tell us about cryoglobulinemia. In this case, this sample was taken from a patient with hepatitis C. Also, we can see that in third case, plasma is totally gallified, so cryoglobulin's concentration here is very, very high. According to Breit classification, we have three types of cryoglobulinemia. The first type is the presence of single monoclonal immunoglobulins. So to explain the pathogenesis, here we have B lymphocytes. B lymphocytes produce antibodies, it's immunoglobulin M and immunoglobulin G. The amount of B lymphocytes in the blood is determined by B lymphocytes production and B lymphocytes apoptosis. If the production of B lymphocytes increase or apoptosis decrease, the amount of B lymphocytes will increase. The most common reason why B lymphocytes increase is decrease in apoptosis. And the most common reason why apoptosis becomes inhibited are lymphoproliferative disorders. It's chronic lymphocytic leukemia, non-Hodgkin lymphoma, and multiple myeloma. So, if production increase or apoptosis decrease, the amount of B lymphocytes increase. With increasing amount of B lymphocytes, the production of antibodies increase. And important that it's monoclonal antibodies, means that all immunoglobulin G antibodies are identical and all immunoglobulin M antibodies are also identical. So increasing amount of B lymphocytes cause increasing amount of monoclonal immunoglobulins. Immunoglobulins are proteins. So with increasing amount of immunoglobulins, total protein count increase. With increasing serum protein concentration, erythrocyte sedimentation rate increase. And also, with increase in protein level, blood viscosity increase. The higher the viscosity, the higher the risk of thrombosis. If thrombosis occurs in the digits, it will cause Raynaud phenomenon. If thrombosis occurs in cerebral circulation, most commonly it will cause blurry vision. And if thrombosis occurs in the digits or toes, it will cause decrease in nutrients delivery, and thereby, with time, it will cause formation of distal ulcers. Thrombosis in peripheral arteries can cause peripheral neuropathy, and also accumulation of monoclonal immunoglobulins in skin microvessels can cause formation of livedo reticularis. So, because in this condition we have just monoclonal immunoglobulins, it's monoclonal immunoglobulin G and monoclonal immunoglobulin M, we call this condition cryoglobulinemia type 1, and the major pathological feature is increase in blood viscosity. The second and third types are mixed types, where we have different immunoglobulins. It can be mix of monoclonal and polyclonal immunoglobulins in type 2, and it can be mix of polyclonal immunoglobulins in type 3. Both type 2 and type 3 cryoglobulinemias are strongly associated with hepatitis C. So let's explain the pathogenesis. Here we have hepatitis C virus, and we know that hepatitis C virus targets liver tissue. The reason is that hepatocytes on their surface have CD81 receptor. Through this receptor, virus can enter into hepatocyte. But also, CD81 receptor is present on B lymphocyte. Hepatitis C virus through CD81 receptor enters into B lymphocyte. The function of B lymphocyte is to produce immunoglobulins. Infection stimulates production of immunoglobulins, but also infection disrupts normal production of immunoglobulins. The first possibility is that in infected state, B lymphocytes begin to produce monoclonal immunoglobulin M and polyclonal immunoglobulin G antibodies. So immunoglobulin M antibodies are copies of each other, and immunoglobulin G antibodies are different. And the specific feature of immunoglobulin M antibodies in hepatitis C infection is rheumatoid factor activity, which means that immunoglobulin M antibodies can bind to Fc portion of immunoglobulin G, and when they bind, they form immune complex. And the state when we have a lot of immune complexes that are composed of monoclonal immunoglobulin M antibodies and polyclonal immunoglobulin G antibodies, we call cryoglobulinemia type 2. The second possibility is that B lymphocytes in response to infection will produce polyclonal immunoglobulin M and polyclonal immunoglobulin G. So all antibodies are completely different. And because in hepatitis C immunoglobulin M has rheumatoid factor activity, immunoglobulin M binds to immunoglobulin G antibodies. And with binding, they form immune complexes. And the state when we have a lot of immune complexes that are composed of polyclonal immunoglobulin M antibodies and polyclonal immunoglobulin G antibodies, we call cryoglobulinemia type 3. And the major problem is that in both types of cryoglobulinemia, we have immune complexes that are very reactive substances. So when immune complex appears in the bloodstream, it binds complement. This results in formation of a massive, highly reactive immune complex. First of all, the position of immune complexes in the skin microvessels provoke palpable purpura. In severe cases, it can cause necrotizing vasculitis that results in formation of ulcers. Here we see a skin biopsy in patient with cryoglobulinemia. First of all, deposition of immune complexes provokes inflammation. And after inflammation, regeneration occurs. And regeneration occurs by deposition of connective tissue, which is fibrin. Exactly fibrin deposits we can see on first two samples. Also, one of the most specific features are neutrophils with nuclear dust. And on last image, we also see that inflammation of the vessel provokes deposition of connective tissue. In fact, mixed cryoglobulinemia can manifest with various rash, but most commonly it causes purpura. Here we see purpura in areas that were compressed. Also here is an example of urticarial vasculitis, and the specific feature is that in this case, burning prevails over itching. Also, there is livida reticularis, which can be present in all cryoglobulinemias. Also, purpura can cause deposition of hemosiderin, and potentially it can cause irreversible pigmentation. And on last two images, vasculitis causes formation of ulcers. Also, complexes can deposit in kidney glomeruli, and potentially this will cause glomerulonephritis. On first image, we see that deposition of immune complexes provoked fibrinoid necrosis. On next two images, we can see membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, which has a specific feature, double contour appearance. Also, precipitated cryoglobulins can cause formation of pseudothrombi. And on last image, we see massive accumulation of immunoglobulin M that results in formation of a thrombi. In the same fashion, immune complexes can deposit in synovium of the joints. This will cause synovitis that typically manifest with arthralgias. Deposition of immune complexes in lung pleura can cause pleuritis that typically cause dyspnea. Also, immune complexes can deposit in blood vessels that supply nerves. In this case, it can cause central nervous system injury. We call this condition vasculitis with CNS involvement, or deposition of immune complexes can cause cranial nerve injury. If immune complexes affect peripheral nerves, this can cause peripheral neuropathy. So here we can see a few images that show the pattern of neural injury. On first image, we can see degeneration of myelinated nerve into two fibers. It's one of the features of vasculitis neuropathy. On second image, we see degeneration of nerve fibers accompanied by extravasation of red blood cells. Extravasation of red blood cells caused by inflammation that increase permeability, and now red blood cells can leak into the tissue. On third image, we can see nerve fibers with epineural mononuclear cellular infiltrates. And on last image, we see nerve fiber and epineural artery. In this case, artery is occluded by a thrombi. Also, we see deposition of connective tissue around the artery as a sign of fibrosis and epineural infiltrates as a sign of inflammation. Immune complexes cause severe systemic inflammation, and systemic inflammation manifests with general symptoms as fatigue, weakness, and fever. Also, we know that immune complexes consist of immunoglobulins. Immunoglobulins are proteins, and increase in protein concentration causes increase in blood viscosity, and increase in viscosity can cause Raynaud's phenomenon. The first step in a Raynaud phenomenon is vasoconstriction or occlusion of arterioles. This causes decrease in blood flow into the digits, as a result ischemia develops and digits becomes white. The second step is prolonged ischemia. Prolonged ischemia causes cyanosis of fingers so they become blue. And the third step occurs after vasoconstriction is gone. So now blood flow is restored and income of arterial blood causes redness. In clinical medicine, to make a diagnosis, we use clinical criteria. In cryoglobulinemia, there are two major features. The first one is vasculitis, because we know that deposition of immune complexes in vessels can cause the inflammation, so vasculitis develops. The second feature is hepatitis C as a major provoking factor, because we know that in cryoglobulinemia type 2 and 3, it's hepatitis C that triggers entire disorder. And as additional features, we have severe inflammation, because we know that immune complexes can cause systemic inflammation that manifests with systemic symptoms as fatigue or fever. The next criteria is articular involvement, because immune complexes can deposit on synovial membrane, and this triggers synovitis that manifests with arthralgias. The third criteria is vascular involvement. Most commonly it's vasculitis. Vasculitis can cause skin injury as purpura, necrotizing vasculitis or skin ulcers. So they all can serve as a sign of vascular injury. But also, increase in blood viscosity can cause vessel occlusion that manifests as Raynaud phenomenon. In this case, typically, Raynaud phenomenon is caused by occlusion of the blood vessels by immune complexes. And the last criteria is neurologic involvement, because immune complexes can affect both CNS and peripheral nervous system. Also, we have laboratory criteria. The first one is decrease in serum complement level, because complement binds to immune complexes with formation of a large complex. Such overactivation of complement causes complement depletion, especially depletion of C4 complement component. The second criteria is positive rheumatoid factor activity, because we know that exactly the ability of immunoglobulin M to bind to immunoglobulin G is the reason why immune complexes are formed. Without rheumatoid factor activity, there will be no immune complexes, and thereby there will be no cryoglobulinemia type 2 and 3. So rheumatoid factor activity should be high. And the third criteria is positive M component on electrophoresis. To explain this, we know that on electrophoresis we can see fractions of proteins in the serum. It's albumins, alpha-1, alpha-2, beta and gamma globulins. And it's how electrophoresis looks like in normal condition. But here we see that gamma fraction is abnormally high, and gamma fraction consists of immunoglobulins. And because immunoglobulins are monoclonal, we call them M component. The treatment of cryoglobulinemia type 2 and 3 is based on elimination of hepatitis C. For this purpose, we use non-structural protein 3 inhibitors. So first of all, we are trying to eliminate the causative factor. In this case, it's hepatitis C. And as we see, we have a lot of non-structural protein 3 inhibitors. And the second goal is to decrease the production of immunoglobulins. And for this purpose, we have to decrease B lymphocytes. Typically, to decrease lymphocytes, we use rituximab. Rituximab is anti-CD20 antibody, and because CD20 receptor is present on B lymphocytes, it binds to B lymphocytes and induces apoptosis. Obviously, the lower is the amount of B lymphocytes, the lower is the production of immunoglobulins, and thereby the lower is the amount of immune complexes. And also, we add glucocorticosteroids, because they also decrease the amount of lymphocytes.